Okay. Oh, all right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Bandung Learnings. I'm Lisa Gold. I'm the Executive Director of the Asian American Arts Alliance, and I am so thrilled that you're here. I'm sorry so many people are still outside, but hopefully they'll make it in during the discussion. Just quick remarks, because I want to keep this short so you can hear from these awesome humans over here. I want to give big thanks to our friends at the Ford Foundation for hosting us tonight. Yes. Whitney, Duval, Rocio, thank you. And then, of course, the incredible team at MoCADA and A4. So Justine Lee, Leo Chang, Danny Wu, Zola, Jordan Savage, who's upstairs, Derek, thank you. And Run, of course, sorry. So I'm gonna turn it over to Amy, my colleague, and I don't know, like, who's been through it all with me, so.
There we go. Well, thank you, Lisa. Can we give a round of applause for Lisa, first and foremost, because I have to do that. Every chance I get, did I even introduce myself? I'm Amy Andrea, I'm the executive director of MoCADA. But I always love to kind of celebrate Lisa first, because one, that's an act of solidarity, to uplift each other, right? And the second thing is, this would not be possible if Lisa never reached out and said, hey, why don't we do something? So I'm always gonna celebrate that fact. So, there you go. But like you said, the show must go on, right? So what's the first question?
Each artist is going to introduce themselves with 2 minutes. I know everybody wants to ask questions. So each artist has 2 minutes to introduce themselves and talk very briefly about their projects, and then we're going to go into the questions.
I was just having an Oprah moment, but we're starting with Margaret, right?
No. Yeah.
Hi, everyone. Oh, okay. Yeah. Can you hear me okay? All right, great. Hi, everyone. My name is Margaret, Margaret Ree, and I'm a educator and poet and also artist. And my project was the Afro-Asian Poetry Pantry, which was a social practice installation that included kind of a combination of like free community refrigerators and free libraries. And they included pocket poems by Black and Asian American poets, writing about solidarity, as well as, like, of course, free food. So there were snacks and different kinds of activations. There was also a video by the poet Ronaldo V. Wilson that was installed. And this was actually installed at MoCADA and Governor's Island, so I can't thank Amy enough and Zola enough and MoCADA for their amazing curation and support. They've been really amazing mentors in this process. And so thank you again to Amy and Zola, to Lisa and Justine, everyone at A4 and MoCADA for their support.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lena Huey, and I am a multidisciplinary artist, originally from New York, but between here and Baltimore. My project is called Divine Intervention Healing Modalities, and it explores a storytelling project that gathers stories from folks that I have interviewed in different capacities, but stories of how we're celebrating our spirituality and the diverse ways that it comes, as well as healing practices. So we explored all things from how we relate to the land that we're a part of, the communities that we're a part of, and how we're moving through these times that we're in. And so it was really beautiful to be able to connect with folks from various walks of life celebrating Black and Asian solidarity. So really grateful for you all to come, and thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Anuj. I use they, them, he, him pronouns. I'm a community organizer and an artist, specifically a restorative justice organizer and a theater and experimental theater maker. And my project was called Bring a Friend, and Bring a Friend has had like a lot of iterations over the past year. The intention of Bring a Friend was to be an exploration of the way we learn about abolitionist futures through queer friendships and queer multiracial friendships across the African and Asian diasporas. And as the project kind of grew and changed, I had this textbook on the science of touch with me that I was exploring the whole time, and it started to grow into this investigation also of like what are all of the forces that keep us away from like the poetics of touch and feeling, and how do those things sometimes pose as like challenges or these moments of tension that we have to move through at a different pace than the rest of society within friendships to actually like envision futures. And so I think, yeah, it's just been a project that's kind of like grown and changed and shifted from this like idealism of friendship to actually being like, what is the slow rhythm of friendship? And what are the waves and motions of that? And how do those bring in a future that we haven't seen? So.
Hi. I am Dana Davenport. I am an artist, primarily working within sculpture, video, and performance. And I joined the residency with Sonia Choi over here. And our project is called Anthology of Transference. And it explores some nuances between Korean and English language through storytelling. I'll let them introduce themselves and talk a little bit.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sonia or Suihan Choi. You can call me either names. I use they, them pronouns. I am an artist and organizer. And yeah, I started this project with my friend Dana here. And yeah, I guess it's kind of like a collection of different like personal stories that kind of like think about like different word or like moments that we want to kind of like explore like the meaning of like migration and like familial relationships, our relationships to our identities and Black and Asian, like the possibility of Black and Asian solidarity. And so, yeah, that's kind of like, we're kind of exploring that relationship through our friendship and through like kind of microcosms.
Hello. Hey guys, my name is Brian, primarily a video producer and director based in New York, but I also run a music label on the side. And so my project is a compilation album called First, Listen, a musical conversation for solidarity. And I may be kind of getting ahead a little bit speaking about solidarity, but I think for me, the reason I really wanted to start this project was I felt like a lot of kind of conflict and confusion between the Asian and Black communities could hopefully be overcome just by kind of listening to each other instead of first imposing your kind of presumptions or just, you know, your history and personal life, but just being open to listening to each other. And I think through that, there's a lot more common ground than you might find between those two communities. And so that's been a great experience watching these artists kind of work together in person and remotely to find those kind of common ground.
Hi, I'm Louise Young. I am a visual artist and an urban planner. My project is focused on documenting herbal traditions in Black and Asian families. And I did a series of interviews with a number of people as individuals, people who are in partnerships, people with intergenerational family members to really explore the ways that herbal practices are passed down or extended to one another, and really interested in focusing on this question of how do we care for one another in ways that are outside of sort of Western modes of institutional care, it was cool to learn about different ways that people want to receive care or want to give care, and some of the sort of shared plant histories of Black and Asian diasporic communities. There was a lot of recipes that I gathered from people who shared about different cold remedies or ailment remedies, and it's been cool to kind of find those common threads around that in our communities.
Hello. Hello? Okay, yes.
Hi. I'm Tiffany, or TD, or my full government name is like somewhere up there. I am a writer and editor and community organizer based in New York for 12 years now, but I'm from Texas. And my project is actually a co-edited anthology with a couple collaborators from Black Women Radicals and WOW. Good timing, an Asian American Feminist Collective. We're working on an anthology on Black and Asian feminist solidarities, and it's going to be published in May 2025. Next year, sorry. And with Haymarket Books, so cool. That's it. Oh, and also Kai is going to be a part of it, so passing it on to Kai.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Kai. I'm a writer and performing artist based in Harlem. My project is a biographical children's picture book about my great-grandmother, who was a Japanese-American freedom fighter by the name of Yuri Kochiyama. And she is someone who is often sort of looked to as a person that exemplified solidarity in movement organizing. She's known for closely participating in a number of racial justice movements, and particularly Black liberation movements, and collaborating and personally supporting like countless organizations and individual activists. So I just wanted to name some of them to give a sense of the scope of her activism. So she's affiliated with the Black Panther Party, the Republic of New Africa, the Young Lords, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, the Congress of Racial Equality, Mumia Abu-Jamal, Malcolm X, Asada Shakur, Lolita LeBron, and many others. And the work of her life was really dedicated to the pursuit of freedom for everyone, because as our oppressions are interconnected, so are our freedoms. So the book kind of chronicles her life from her upbringing as this like self-identified American patriot who was really politically ambivalent and apolitical in her youth, through her incarceration in a Japanese American concentration camp, to her entry into activism and her radicalization in Harlem in the 60s. And it also goes through her friendship with Malcolm X. I'm gonna wrap up, but I just wanted to shout out my collaborators. The book is illustrated by Anastasia Magliore Williams, and it is being published by Kaepernick Publishing, which is run by and founded by Colin Kaepernick, and it's called The Bridges Yuri Built, How Yuri Kochiyama Marched Across Movements. So it will be out April 4th this year. Thank you.
Big shoes to fill after Kai, but I'm Sunny. I use they or she pronouns, and I joined Bandung Residency working on my project called Presence solo, but then I was fortunately joined by Malaika, so I'll let her introduce herself, and then we'll talk about the project together.
Hello. My name is Malaika Temba. I use she, her pronouns. I started this residency with a project that I felt like was really kind of safe for me. I'm a textile artist, and it kind of was in line with the work I was making, but I also joined the residency with the intention of like meeting and talking to and working with other organizers and people that are interested in, you know, this solidarity work. And so I joined Sunny on their project, which do you wanna start talking
about? Oh, of course. So. Some more background, I am an interdisciplinary artist who often works with installation, sculpture, and video. And so that was kind of the form that I was envisioning for the project. But I really wanted to try something large scale. So at first I wanted these projections, but then had to scale down, as often happens. But I'm also an organizer, and so from that lens, I noticed that when we talk about abolition, a lot of times what people envision is what we don't want to see. We don't want to see carceral systems, we don't want to see police, we don't want to see jails, but not so much what we want to see instead. And so our project was really trying to look at how can we convince and people that everyone's a little bit of an abolitionist in some way. No one really wants to put in all these resources into building systems that will further harm Black and brown communities. And what do we want instead to pour those resources into? And so in New York, we were thinking about specifically the neighborhoods of Harlem and Chinatown. I'll talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so I guess we were looking at these two sites where there was city funding going towards development of jails, and we kind of had these different installations, activations, different things to ask the community members, like, what would they rather see in that space and with that funding. And so we kind of started at the end of our cohort, at the end of this cohort's residency, but we did the extension of the Bandung residency. And we did an installation at Governor's Island that was with MoCADA. That was really a really great experience. And it involved projecting the responses that we got from a community survey in Harlem. And Sunny did a workshop in Chinatown. So we projected the responses on the ceiling of this room in Governor's Island. In the house, sorry, I'm nervous. And invited viewers to then write down their responses to the same question. And so we've kind of been in this research stage of like really just asking everybody what they think and kind of compiling and synthesizing other people's voices for now. But we're still working on things.
Now, can I get my Oprah on? Yeah? Okay. Okay. I love what Kai said a few minutes ago, the pursuit of freedom for everyone. Like, that was, I was like, that's my definition of solidarity, you know? But what does it mean for each of you? What does solidarity look like, and where do you draw inspiration to kind of craft what solidarity is throughout your projects? Anybody can go. I'm going to start with Anuj, because Anuj looked at me.
Hi. What does sorry. Okay, what does solidarity mean to me? Okay, so I've been thinking a lot about like the womb space. And I mentioned this book on the science of touch earlier, but like one of the scientific facts in it that I feel like I've carried with me a lot is that the feeling of touch is the first of our five senses that develops in the womb. And so when we think about like sensory recall in the body, the thing that our body can trace back to is this thing that we are born from. But like as humans, we like take in a lot through audio and visual, but through those senses, the womb is harder to remember, right? And I think about this idea of like what it means to try to remember, like to spend a whole life trying to remember the thing that you're from. And you put that next to like the experience of diaspora, and a huge part of diaspora is like I have to spend my entire life trying to like remember or build a vision of this thing that I am from with what I have, which may not be a lot, right? And so when I think about solidarity, I think for me it means like building a womb space for one another. And because we don't have a blueprint directly of like what that is through all of our senses, it's like the willingness to also like try to build that space with people again and again and again. So that's
that was really awesome. I'm glad I picked you first. No one wants to go now? Come on, y'all. Like, seriously. We've heard you talk about solidarity so much. All of you have...
That was so perfect.
Right? It was. But there's so many ways that solidarity shows up, right? And there's so many ways to define it. And I think it's important for people to know that, because oftentimes we think about the words like solidarity, abolition, and they seem massive, and that we can't step into those shoes, right? So I think part of the reason why we're asking this question is to hear that, to see that reflected here on this stage, but also allow folks who are sitting out there to say, I receive that, I can do that, right? So, Brian, since you stepped
yes,
up
Amy.
For it.
I think, yeah, it is tough. It's a grand thing that I think a lot of people try to practice daily, but in practice, it is a very difficult thing to kind of nail down. And I think, at least for me, growing up as a Korean American in the suburbs, and then eventually going off to college and becoming a professional and living in New York, I think a lot of it had to do with unlearning a lot of what was passed down to me from my parents and my immediate community living in the suburbs, which is predominantly white and pretty wealthy. And so I think unlearning that, and at the same time, what helped me kind of unlearn that was hanging out a lot with more and more non-white friends of mine, and even the very receptive and open white ones. I think they kind of have shown me what we can kind of learn from each other, and that there are other options of or ways of kind of not just seeing people, but welcoming people and hearing what they have to offer in a way that's not just performative, but very meaningful. And I think that's something I've been very grateful for over the path of my life, is the people that I've met and learning from them, and you know, kind of going back to the album title for my project is just kind of listening to them before trying to speak what I think is the answer, I guess.
Can I talk?
Go for it.
Okay. Yeah, what you said just made me think about something. So I think we've all already nailed it, that like solidarity, like love, is an action. It's not just like a feeling or a thought that you have. You know, you can't just be like, I declare that I'm in solidarity. And then that just means that you are. But I think maybe people kind of practice that way, like how people practice love that way. But yeah, I went last night. I went to a memorial for Cecilia Gentile, who passed this week. She is like a fierce trans sex worker, you know, queer activist, migrant, who apparently touched a lot of hearts. I think that we knew that, but like last night, listening to everyone talk about her was like extremely inspirational and just like filled my heart, because I feel like what I reflected on while listening to everyone like just express their like love and gratitude for her was that what she did was like grow more and more capacious like for her community throughout her years. And I feel like that to me right now is like how I'm visualizing solidarity, is like someday whenever I pass and people are like remembering me, that they remember that I like was constantly extending myself for others or welcoming people, you know, allowing people to feel at home.
You guys are really gonna make me call on you.
I think I was also just reminded of, I had a different answer. I'm going to say both of my answers. But one thing that I really feel strongly about after working on this project is to be in solidarity with the generations before me is very important, and to kind of like make sure that all the work that's been done gets remembered and gets, you know, passed on. And so I think that is a really important kind of way of expressing solidarity. But then the other thing that I was gonna say is, in working with Sunny and in all of our long conversations about kind of like does this make sense? Does this approach seem like it's right or wrong? Or all of these kind of like, I don't know how we got so deep into these different questions, but it was always such a joy and such a wonderful experience to kind of just like talk through them with you. And I feel like that was really those times were also really like times where I was like, this is what solidarity is for sure, because it just made everything so much easier to kind of parse through these really complicated ideas and situations. Yeah, so I feel like that was really important to me as well.
So solidarity is a verb, it's an action, it's a love, it's communion with one another, it's respect, it's all of these things, right? But how does transformation fit into that? Because I also hear there's a change, there's something that's coming from this space into this space. How transformative, let me rephrase that. How did you transform, and how did your projects transform along this journey? And I'm gonna start with you guys at the end here, Dana, Sonia.
Wait, me? Oh, okay.
Both of you.
All right. Hey. How did I change? I'm not quite sure, but I was definitely really inspired by Dana, because just like seeing her art, like over the years, like she's really a perfectionist in what she does, and I'm sorry, to embarrass you like this, but I don't know. I think I learned a lot from, I guess like our processes were very different. Like I think before working with Dana, I was very cerebral with my work. Like I would think about my idea and then the kind of like physical manifestation of it would come afterwards. But I think I tried a different approach where I thought about like the physical material first, because we were thinking about like 보자기, which is like this silk, like, or any wrapping cloth. It's like kind of like an old thing that Korean people did in the past, where like instead of bags, you would have 보자기, where you wrap your books or like food or whatever into the cloth, or you can also call it 보따리, like the how elders call it, but. we were thinking about that object and migration and like how as like immigrants to like different countries, like you kind of consume like your own like culture through like the time that you left, or like through your family stories. And so there can be like a disconnect temporally of like what's going on. And so we were thinking about that and thinking about like migration and like what we would want to kind of put in that, and thinking about like how different objects like symbolize like memories and memory making. So I'm sorry, I'm kind of rambling, but do you want to add on to that?
Yeah, of course. I'll start by also describing my own transformation during this project. I think I learned to become a better collaborator. It's really, just as Sonia had described, I think that we work pretty differently, which I guess can seem kind of intimidating. I recently moved to LA, so a lot of this was happening virtually, and we would have these discussions, kind of make a plan for what to come back to the next meeting with. And we would we'd speak about it, think that we're on the exact same page, and then we'd somehow approach it really differently in a way that really pushed our project further. And it is true, I'm a bit of a perfectionist. and I think working with Sonia allowed me to like let go of that a little bit. And kind of lean in to, I guess, a less like strategized way of working and a more intuitive way of working. So that's been really exciting.
I'm going to throw Louise under the bus really quickly, because I remember at the beginning you were doing these interviews, right? Can you talk about how that was a transformative process for you?
Sure. Yeah, my project started off being very interview-based. I was also like really anxious to have them. So Amy and Lisa both gave me a lot of like pointers about, and some people that I interviewed are here, shout out. And I think like one of the things that kind of evolved for me over this process is thinking about like different scales of care. So like a lot of my interviews were very personal, like asking like, how, when you're not feeling well, what do you need to feel cared for? And then in the extension process, I did a little remix and started collaborating with my longtime friend Daphne, who is in the audience and was a first year Bandung fellow. And both of us are urban planners and neighbors and friends. And we started talking a lot about, like, it's kind of like a different take on transformation, I guess, but like, what does it look like to have the structural conditions that can foster solidarity? So like the two of us in our friendship, I think we talk about ways that we practice solidarity within our friendship, and that's like a scale at which you can really move through conflict and you can really kind of like get to know each other's histories and what you bring into this space with each other. But then like zooming out, it's like, well, what did it take for us to get here? Like structurally, like Black and Asian communities are not often living side by side because of racist housing and immigration policies. And you know, to what Brian said, like growing up, you know, you might have grown up in different contexts. And so thinking about like as urban planners, what does it look like to actually design cities that actually prioritize solidarity and community building as a goal beyond the kinds of other goals that we have, like jobs or, you know, whatever. And so part of our workshop that we did was last week, using a play and placemaking as a form of exploring what this could look like. So we had a bunch of found objects, like toilet paper rolls and, you know, kind of discarded boxes that we painted fun colors, and asked people to imagine, like, what are spaces that you crave or that you could reimagine or transform that right now don't have those kinds of conditions but could. And so there's a couple of photos from that workshop. But when I think about transformation, I'm thinking about both, like, how do we transform each other, which a lot of people have talked about here in our individual friendships and relationships, but also then what does that look like to transform this, like, in a very structural way that we currently don't really do.
That was brilliant. Like, seriously, that was brilliant. And I can't remember exactly how you, I'm like, hi. I can't remember how you guys said it before, because whenever you guys talk about your project, the extension project, and I should explain what the extension is, right?
Yeah.
So in year one, the Bandung residency was about 3 or 4 months. So for cohort two, we said, okay, we're gonna do the same thing. But what we noticed from the first cohort was that they needed more time to kind of process the information, like the things that they were learning, the things that they were experiencing, how they were building a community. So we decided to come up with an experiment during cohort two, actually. We said, what if we said, let's extend this. What would it look like if it were over a year-long process? Or even if we just added another couple of months to allow our residents to dive even deeper into their subject matter, or even remix. Like, a couple of people remixed their projects. And it was beautiful to see, because there was deeper engagement, right? There was more collaboration. We saw solidarity taking shape in real time. So now I think next year, cohort three, we're like, okay, it's going to be a year. Just go. But since we're on the subject, I'm trying to hurry up because I want to make sure that we leave time for questions. You know, Louise mentioned community building and some of the challenges that might come with community building. Can you guys talk about that? The challenges, the positives, the negatives. What was your experience coalition building within the community? Also thinking outside of echo chambers, because we talk about that a lot too. How do we, as organizers, educators, creators, kind of stop ourselves from kind of speaking to the people who are already aware? How do we go beyond that and touch new people and invite and widen the conversation? Kai?
Can I go?
Go for it.
We're
gonna take this one.
Well, something I don't remember exactly what you just said, Amy, that triggered this thought, but something I have been thinking about when I think about coalition and people from distinct communities working to build supportive relationships with one another is this idea of what solidarity work asks of us and how it asks us to extend ourselves across differences. And that it asks us to extend ourselves in ways that may not always be comfortable. So I think that it requires us to sometimes, or looks like, going to places where we may not feel we inherently belong, maybe because we are not of a specific community, and like putting ourselves in rooms we may not otherwise occupy when we are invited, but also seeking out those invitations. And that it's important to like create community amongst ourselves that are not just defined by our identities, but are defined by our politics, and how when we build coalition, we're uniting underneath shared politics, which is also its own form of identity. But I bring that up because I think there can, when we're doing this work of building relationships between our communities, like there can be this pressure to not overstep boundaries. But I don't, and it's imperative actually to acknowledge the way that like our identities position us against each other or around each other, and to acknowledge those differences and privileges as well that we may have over others. But I don't want us to be beholden to difference in a way that makes us shy of each other. So that's something I've been thinking about, the messiness of this work, how it asks us to be willing to be challenged, so put ourselves at risk of like conflict and tension and difficult emotions and difficult encounters, which I think are almost always going to arise, like especially when we're talking about communities that have been historically and continue to be positioned against one another, like Black and Asian communities, to serve the interests of white supremacy.
Finally, I was waiting for this word, but go ahead, sorry.
No. Thank you. But yeah, I think that we know that these things are going to arise, but we have to respect one another enough to struggle with each other. And I think Dr. Connie Wun said that freedom is not always a friendly struggle. So I really want us to hold that when we're talking about working amongst our communities and within our communities. But I feel like I said a lot of like meandering things, so I'm gonna.
I was
leave
like,
it
you could
there.
Just keep the mic for the rest of the night. We're good, I think. Lena, good.
Yeah, I think a lot of this, in terms of solidarity, transformation, all of these areas, it's exploring or understanding that, for me at least, solidarity means to hold space, and understanding that. That can mean many different things, right? So for at least a lot of the folks that I spoke with and got to build with through this project, we are talking like years of friendship, deep friendship. Folks who, you know, have transitioned through loss, family losses, family transitions, crisis, right? Birth, all of these things. So, you know, this is what it is to be human, right? Constantly being in transition. So being able to hold space for what you can see and what you can't see, right? So what's underneath, and I always think about it as a garden space. So, you know, you're cultivating this garden space that bears fruit at times, and then other times you're not bearing fruit, and it's quiet, and there's a lot of loss, right, or quiet time. So understanding all of those seasons that happen within our bodies, within our minds, within our families and our communities as well. And so to be able to honor that space, and through the conversations that we have with each other, through holding space, through speaking, you know, on behalf of the other, right? Maybe creating a voice where there isn't, how meaningful that is, right? And how important that work is. And for me, my daughter's 9, so for her to see that and all of these generations coming together through story sharing is such a powerful thing, but it's a never-ending, it's alive, right? Like this work is, it doesn't end with one person or the loss of one person. It's a constant.
Margaret, you want to close this up?
Just to build on what Lena and Kai shared, I love this metaphor of the garden. I think that is so moving and so true of the nurturing and the growth that happens, and you know the thriving that can happen with the garden, but also the quiet moments and the difficulties, right? The struggle that Kai talked about. So, yeah, I just want to echo what you both shared. And I think it is that delicate balance, right? Of like creating space, but also the struggle. Like one will most likely, if you're doing the work of solidarity, be uncomfortable. And that's part of it, that's the gift. Because if we were all comfortable, then we wouldn't be doing the work, I think, right? So learning about one another and like different experiences, acknowledging our own privilege, our relationships to power and how different they may be. It's such a delicate balance. So I love this garden. it's really beautiful. So yeah, I guess I just want to echo what everyone said. And you know, for myself, I also have the experience of long-term friendships of people, of doing this work together of solidarity and love. And one of the videos in the installation of my project is with Vanessa Lewis, and she's like my friend for like 20 years, and we're like best friends in the Bay Area, like young queers, like roaming around doing a lot of crazy stuff, and we both came from LA. You know, my mother worked in a beauty supply store in Watts, very typically Korean immigrant experience, and then she lived nearby. Yet we met in the Bay Area, and we were working with like the Queer Women of Color Media Arts Project. So we would go back, you know, have our moms come together, and just anyway, we just did a lot of really fun, beautiful things in the Bay Area. So we did this video, and we talked about it. She has a new book that just came out last week, Reclaiming Ugly. If you could check it out, I'm going to give a shout out to her. But I learned so much from her about solidarity and like vice versa, like what it means to come of age in our 20s in the Bay Area during the aughts, and what that looked like, you know, across gender, across class, you know, immigration, all of the differences that we had, and yet the solidarity and love and care we had for each other. And I think this is might be just generationally when you're a certain age and you've had friendships for, you know, 20 years or so, or more, of course, you bear that gift, that nurturing gift that we're going to do this work together of what it means to, like, walk in a store and we're taken up differently, right, and really acknowledge that, or having differences around, you know, class backgrounds, you know. Actually, she was living in Watts, but also from very middle-class Black home that was actually very different from my background of being very working-class and immigrant. So we had all these differences. So yeah, so the video that we made in the summer just reflected on all of that and our continuing solidarity and love. And I think that is what it's about. It's about the work, it's about the learning, but also the generosity to extend to one another, to build that space and to garden and cultivate and nurture.
That was really beautiful. And the fact that you were so soft-spoken as you were saying it, That was really nurturing as well. So just going to throw that out there. Can we get a round of applause for them, please? Aren't they amazing? Justine just added the mics. So that means you can come up and ask questions. So if you have questions, don't be shy. There's a mic to my left, mic to the right. Mm-hmm. They are here to answer. I was like, are you coming up to ask a question? Yes. No, that is Jamel. Hi, Jamel. Hey, Jamel. Cohort one also. Yeah. Hey, shout out.
Shout out to a number of residents that are here. Rohan.
Hi, Rohan. Yes. And Daphne in the back.
Yes, sorry. I don't have my glasses on. So
does anyone have questions? Are you guys just afraid? I'm going to pass the mic to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Freddie Ellis. I'm a former public school teacher. I taught for many years. I was a music teacher, music therapist. I retired a couple of years ago. But my main question is, how do I join this organization? I'm retired, but I still do music. I have albums out with children, and I'm generally interested in what contribution, as a former teacher, what contribution could I make, and how do I go about joining the organization?
Well, we, as Amy noted, we are opening the next cohort of Bandung 3, and I don't remember when.
I think it's June.
Was it June?
Wait, oh, that, you're right.
Oh, okay.
Actually,
April. Yeah, Justine knows all the answers. She has.
Yeah, so we're opening applications for cohort 3 in April, and we will take some time to evaluate with an independent review panel. And then we'll be making our decisions in early June, and the cohort will officially begin by the end of June. So it's coming up. And if you're interested, just follow either MoCADA or A4, better yet, both.
Or both.
And you'll definitely be kept in the loop about what's next.
Thank you. Yeah, we definitely welcome this. Since nobody's getting up here, there's two things that I wanted to share. So hopefully you'll all stick around and join us for the reception afterwards. Right out here, where we will be playing the music that is part of Brian's project. So I know you all want to hear that. And I wanted to ask a question because I got some fan mail from Bob Lee at the Asian American Arts Center, who's a longtime fan of the movements. And actually, Malika, you had mentioned that it was important for you to be in solidarity with elders. And since Bob is one of the OGs, part of the Association of American Cultures, I'm kind of curious like what you learned from that or what your experiences were.
I think it's that things can be urgent, but they also take time, mainly. I think that would be the main thing. And just like, That relieved a lot of anxiety for me, to feel like it's not about what I think change looks like traditionally all the time. It's just about what you can do for people around you. And yeah.
Did you want to add?
Yeah, a lot of my interviews for the herbal traditions practice were intergenerational, so like a lot of people were like, let me ask my parent or my older relative. One of my friends called his mom and like recorded their conversation. At first she was like, I don't know anything about this. She's a Korean immigrant. She's like, I don't know, I have nothing to say. And then she talked for 45 minutes straight, like
so
giving
classic,
all this history. And so I really appreciated that a lot of these interviews were either directly or indirectly invoking, kind of like intergenerational communications around it in ways that, at least for a lot of diasporic folk, like we don't ask our parents these kinds of things in a very, kind of natural way. And even ones that I didn't directly talk to someone's like elder, I think a lot of people talked about learning from, family practices, and I really appreciated hearing about all of that.
Yeah, awesome. I think we have a question over here.
There's one with this.
Oh, yeah. I saw this one first. Sorry.
Hello. Is this working? Hi, everyone. I'm Mitsu. I'm a community builder, researcher, and educator in the mental health space. You guys are all super inspiring. This is amazing. Lena, is that how you say your name? You mentioned embodiment and feeling tension and discomfort. And this is a question for you or anyone else who wants to offer something. What was the process like for you to sit with that discomfort, really embody it, and work through it, like move through that? Because that's a tension I often experience, and I would just love some insight. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a part of life, right? This is just another cycle. So just learning how to digest it can be a challenge, especially when you're juggling a lot, right, for your, like in your own life. So I think it's really about opening up space for a conversation. So rather than running away from the from whatever tension there is, acknowledging what it is that you're feeling, sitting with it, and then see how you can approach a conversation, you know? And from that, your perspective might change, you know? Mm-hmm. Or the perspective of others around you might change, I think it can be really scary, right? When you don't know where that's coming from or why. And it also brings up a lot of tension within the body. And so I think any way that you can, I was sharing in one of our sessions that I just love aimlessly walking just to get the tension out. So that's one of my best, like my favorite go-tos, essential oils. I'm all about rose and lavender. So just anytime I'm like feeling that, I just have that around me. Prayer is a really big part of my personal practice. So yeah, just being able to kind of return to like any rituals that help me get back to center, but also like being able to reach someone, like that's part of solidarity, right? Even when it's difficult, like I'm really struggling with this right now, even if it comes out like this. You know, like, for them to hold space for you in that moment is really important. It's not always the easiest thing to do.
Hi, everyone. My name is Truth. And first of all, thank you all so much for your reflections on what solidarity is and what it could look like. My question is to everyone and anyone who wants to answer, but I'm wondering if there was a certain text that acted like a guiding light during your project. And I think a text can be more than words. It can be a performance or a memory, just something that you referred to throughout your project and that offered guidance. Thank you.
Great question. Something that inspired me while we were working on the project was Cha Hak-kyung or Teresa Hak-kyung Cha's work, Dikte, because I feel like her book kind of, it's really sad what happened to her, but I feel like her work really kind of like played with language in a way that I thought was like really interesting. And kind of like talking about her experience of you know, being born from a family that experienced war and like colonization and like the kind of brokenness of language from that, and like coming to America and like experiencing a new language. And yeah, I thought that was really inspiring for me.
Hi, I'll also share a couple of things. One was an Instagram post from several years back. I cannot remember who posted it, but it was this sort of resource guide for folks, for Korean folks that wanted to speak with their parents about Black Lives Matter, what it meant to them, and just literally how to say some of these things in the Korean language. And I just found that to be such a beautiful resource, of course, but it just also made me think about how it can be difficult to have some of these conversations with your loved ones when there is a language barrier. And so I think about that a lot with my own family. And the other thing is that my mom sometimes writes me birthday letters in Korean, and so I can't read them very well. But I had them translated, and they inspire me.
I can take it as well. I think something that Malik and I thought a lot about in our piece was what gave rise to the title Presence. It's from a Ruth Wilson Gilmore quote, and I'm sure everyone here probably knows who the iconic person is, but the quote is about essentially how abolition isn't absence, but it's rather the presence and what exists. What we want in the future in terms of an abolitionist vision already exists in the present day world in pieces and fragments. This is a paraphrasing. Obviously, her original words are so much better than mine, but all that to say is I feel like whether it is solidarity that we're looking for, whether it is a future that is abolitionist or whatever we think can provide that sort of collective liberation does already exist, whether that's in friendship, whether that's in intergenerational care, whether that's in the residency, et cetera. And so I think that a lot of these larger abstract political theories and ideals feel like they are really hard to grasp, but when you put it into these simpler terms of like what that materially can look like, you do see it all around us. And so that's something that I think really helped us. And when we were thinking about like our project and we were asking folks in Harlem and Chinatown what they wanted to see instead of a jail that would better serve and keep their community safe, a lot of people answered with spaces that would bring them joy, that would bring together a community, whether that is a square for people to dance in, or if you've ever seen like Asian elders dancing to like a boombox. So people were talking about whether that's a banquet hall in Chinatown, whether that's like a third space in Harlem where people can gather for free and have intergenerational conversations and just play and be joyful. I think these are all things that do exist in some ways. But of course, it would be even better if there were more of these pieces and fragments that exist in collective. So also thinking about like what Luis is thinking about and in collaboration with Daphne in terms of like what structures can make these pieces and fragments possible is also just something that we can all collectively build towards. But if that seems too much, I think aiming for those pieces and fragments is also just as worthy and beautiful.
So there's a bookstore in Oakland called Bandung Books. It's like door to door with the Eastside Arts Alliance, which is like one of the only places in the United States that has like an active archive of things about the Bandung Conference. But when I was at Bandung Books, I picked up this book called Navigating Without Instruments. And it's like a book of poetry and essays and visual diagrams by Tracy Kato Kiriyama. And she's a community organizer, but tells a lot of stories through this book around intersections of experiences around childbirth and having chronic sickness. And you know, she poses these questions in it. That's like, if you know that your DNA isn't going to be passed down, and this isn't like, she doesn't talk about it in like a you need to leave a legacy at large concept, but like, what do you offer to your people concept? Like, what do you do? And she makes the strong case for creation, like creating through all the modes that you know how to. And just thinking back to like an answer that was in my head for one of the earlier questions around like how did my relationship to my project change is that I generally became like really disillusioned with language in my project. And was like, there's so many words that we use, like accountability and trust and community and all of the words that I feel like as an organizer, I'm really used to just like I can make you like a lexicon of like the 30 most common words that I hear as an organizer, you know? And also feeling disillusioned of this idea of like every time we all say them, I just don't know what we mean. And it was just interesting because this book came at this moment of like disillusionment, and I like really like started a lot of my performance work through movement and through dance. And so I think one of the things that was cool about this book is that it arrived at this time that was like, great, I can focus on like all the other ways beyond words that I know how to create. And I actually feel like all this stuff beyond words, like within friendship, within solidarity, is actually where like all of this stuff grows and blossoms. And just to go back to the womb, like we don't have words or language in the womb. We have this like eternal essence, you know? And that moves through the body in so many ways. So yeah, Navigating Without Instruments, it's a really beautiful book.
Does anyone else want to add? All right, guys, I think that's it, yeah? Do we want to say some final, do you want to share some final thoughts?
Final words? I want to thank you, Amy, and I want to thank all these amazing artists and our team and Daphne and Jamal and Rohan and the other Bandung residents out here. I hope that you'll take the time to talk with these incredible people and ask them more about their projects, and I hope that this work continues. Again, thank you to the Ford Foundation for supporting this vision and for having us here tonight. Thank you.
We did it.